Spider-Man No Way Home. What can I say about it? Oh my gosh. Three. Awesome. Totally awesome. Like the Trinity. I cannot believe it. On the same screen. So, so epic. I mean, hot. And I mean hot. Spider-Man freaking hot. Whew, ladies, you're gonna love it. The MTV's best villains, best, I can't even think, best fight scenes, absolutely best superhero epic movie ever made. To this day, I would go see it again and again and again, over and over again. You hear me? Again and again and again. Pun intended. Amazing. Pun also intended. Spider-Man No Way Home. What can I say about it? Oh my gosh. Three. Awesome. Totally awesome. Like the Trinity. I cannot believe it. On the same screen. So totally epic.
I just want to say these people couldn't be here right now, so I'm doing this for them and playing the audio back on how they feel about the Spider-Man movie.
I mean, hot. And I mean, hot. Okay. Spider-Man, okay. Freaking
okay.
Hot.
Okay, enough of that one. Here's person number two.
What can I say about this movie? Honestly, this movie was an 11 out of 10 film. It's one of the best I've ever seen, if not the best. I love to see all three of the Spider-Mans together. It was epic. Everyone in the theater was screaming. As soon as Toby came on the screen, it was like a breath of fresh air to see the three Spider-Mans coming together and fighting crime together and saving the world. Because with great power comes great responsibility, and they've shown immense strength. Honestly, to see them all together was just, like I said, a breath of fresh air. And Tom Holland, amazing actor. Tobey Maguire, amazing actor. Andrew Garfield, amazing actor. Andrew Garfield, honestly, was hilarious. And all three of them together had me cracking up so freaking bad. And you could just tell that those Spider-Man roles really never left them, because they are Peter Parker and nothing will ever change that. And it's like they never left their roles, because those roles will always be a part of them. I'm terribly sad about certain scenes that I won't mention, just in case anyone hasn't seen the movie that's listening to this review. But go see it, please.
I just want to stop right here and say, if you haven't seen it, if you watched this far, what are you doing? Just go watch it. Go watch it now. Don't keep watching this video. Go watch it now. Finish this video later. But that's only if you haven't seen it. This is person number three. Okay. You ready? Okay. They're kind of quiet, so give me a moment. Is the third person.
Okay, the reason I like the Spider-Man movie is because I really like that all the Spider-Man characters got together into like one group and just fought for their lives. And I really like the ending too. It was really happy, but one of the sad parts and like the downfall that I really didn't like was that Aunt May had to die, which was really, really sad. I was hoping that they could somehow, like, make it come back to life, but, like, I guess it's not possible. But I really like that the characters came together. Don't like the part where one of the Spider-Mans almost died. It's kind of spoiler, sorry. And I really like that I got to see the two other Spider-Mans, because I didn't get to watch neither one of their movies, because I was born after both of their movies. But one of the exciting things is that the end of stuff is like a happy note, One of the references I didn't like was that I didn't like there was a lot of bad enemies for Spider-Man. Like, at the beginning, I think there were, like, Octavius, and I really didn't like that.
So, let me see. Finally, my turn. Spider-Man No Way Home was one of those movies that I only heard it was good. I didn't know what to expect walking in, but it lived up to the hype, marketing, rumors, etc. Even memes. I mean, I don't want to say it lived up to my expectations because I was expecting Firestar, Iceman, but, you know, their meetings, and, like, Kevin Feige, he just now made that X-Men movie, whatever, canon, and we're not going to talk about that today, or whatever, but my point is, they are his amazing friends, and Spidey has friends everywhere, so maybe eventually we'll see them. There was recently this storyline that Marvel had, featuring Gwen X Green Goblin. So I don't know how that affects Andrew Spider-Man in this huge Spider-Verse. Maybe he'll find his Gwen in another movie with Black Cat, as that was kind of mentioned. So now I want to, like, analyze these characters and their development. Daredevil met Spidey for the first time. That's cool, even if it wasn't Marvel, because fans wanted him back. Stuff like this must happen more often. We must get Jessica Jones back. We must get that Ghost Rider back. We must get freaking Luke Cage back. All of them. Netflix, man, there's just so many good Netflix characters that I wish could pop up in the MCU. And Tom Holland, Petey the Third, I'm going to call him. Learned to be more responsible with each new mission he got. Andrew Petey the Second, you could see he was still grieving and was able to stay strong through little stuff like jokes and how much citizens still wanted him as Spidey, so he could not move on from events like Gwen's death, his Uncle Ben's death. So he was still puzzled about who to talk to. Toby, Petey the Third, had way more experience as Spidey, so he was used to much of his power when fighting his foes, which led to him being a good mentor. That was his development. Like, it was kind of like a rehabilitation process. He didn't want Tom to kill Osborn because he was afraid he'd make the same mistake as him. So hearing them all talk about Uncle Ben, even though Tom was a little unaware of the quotes because he was probably younger when his Ben died, they all helped solve the problems. Like, even Tom helped, you know, the villains and, you know, what's his name? Toby was all like, Andrew, you know, you'll find another girl. Just wait a while. You know, one day she will come walking up to you, like something like that. But now, the film's theme, I feel like the movie was kind of intense, kind of one of those resilience movies. The way people mistreat the real heroes, especially since J. Jonah Jameson was acting all anti-mask, the way he kept saying, that's Spidey Menace. The way Tom Holland and Petey III stopped Doctor Strange from using the box proves that the future is written and we decide our own fate. Strange kept talking about the multiverse, meaning that people want the multiverse's future to remain unpredictable. Yet, if the MCU doesn't keep its promises, many of its viewers, you know, will mock the failure of the MCU's, you know, the predictions that they'll be making about, you know, the characters and, you know, their future and where they lie, where the future lies in the MCU is what I'm trying to say. Now, the filmmaking style, cinematography, I'm going to go straight to the Wikipedia, hopefully it doesn't lie for this. In pre-production, in April 2021, Sony rescheduled No Way Home release date to November 5th, 2021 due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Although the film was originally meant to be set after the events of Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness 2022, aspects of the plot were rewritten after the release date of the later film was delayed. In June, Marisa Tomei confirmed, I think that's how you pronounce her last name, confirmed she would return as May Parker along with Watts as director. She was hopeful that May's work as community organizer would be featured in the film. The next month, Holland said production was planned to take place from late 2020 to February 2021, and Sony shifted the film's release date to December 17th, 2021. Tony Revolori was also confirmed to be reprising his role as Flash Thompson. In early October, Jacob Batalon, and Benedict Cumberbatch were set to reprise their MCU roles of Ned Leeds and Dr. Stephen Strange, while Jamie Foxx was set to return as Max Dillon Electro. I wonder if that's the same Electro, like the normal Electro. Because I don't know his actual name in the comics, so I'm kind of wondering if, you know, that's his name in the comic. From Mark Webb's The Amazing Spider-Man 2, 2014, while filming beginning later in the month, gosh, I definitely know how to pronounce this dude's name, Green McMillan from The Hollywood Reporter felt that Strange's inclusion was not a coincidence considering the character's connection to the multiverse and the casting of the past Spider-Man film. Actors like Fox, immediately prior to the beginning of the film, several other key actors in the film had yet to sign on. According to Holland, the film needed all or none of the actors in order to be produced. So hopefully none of that was a lie, because, you know, some people say Wikipedia be lying. And the tone was very action and adventurous. It had a tad bit of comedy drama in a few parts, but it was mainly action and adventurous. The sound design was nothing too cool. I was expecting the Spider-Man does whatever a spider can, spins a web any size. But, you know, the sound design was just whatever. And the story structure, Tom Holland was still in, you know, high school at this start, being a spider senior, finishing, moving into summer, where he starts applying to colleges, only to be, you know, disappointed and stuff. So yeah, that was kind of a sad part for the people watching, because, you know, as some people say, let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future. Extreme hopes are born into extreme misery, you know. Great hopes make great men, stuff like that. And some of the things people say. But yeah, while hoping the villains of Sinister Six return to the original nature, I'm not sure if the six members were supposed to be Ned's Hobgoblin, Venom, or those that didn't get to come through that wormhole of a portal. The special effects were good in the Spider-Man vs. Strange match, Magic vs. Math, and in the Mirror Dimension. Acting, I'm going to give acting props to everybody in that movie, Flash and Ned's Abuela. Direction, must have took over 1,000 reshoots for Jon Watts. Just joking. He perfected it, though. Especially Aunt May's death. I swear that was the best part. And pacing, the MCU chooses the best release dates. I wish the DCEU could be more like that. But I feel like releasing movies sooner does nothing for the crew members, you know? All jokes aside. And last thing I want to add before, you know, I end this is, I can't wait to see a Spider-Man versus Venom scene. I can't remember that spell Doctor Strange did on Spider-Man for everybody to forget who Peter Parker was and or his identity, at least. But I don't know how that affects Spider-Man. And hopefully, you know, he appears in another movie again soon. But yeah, a lot of people want Andrew Garfield to come back. And what I want to say about Andrew Garfield is that, I just have something to say. Let me see. Oh, yeah. Hold up, let me find it. And maybe he'll find his Gwen in another movie. If he does have another movie, is what I'm trying to say. If Andrew has another movie, hopefully it'll be like somebody like Black Cat or something. Because, like, imagine if we got a movie with Andrew Garfield Spider-Man and Black Cat. Like, say if he was Sony Spider-Man and Tom Holland could continue being MCU Spider-Man. So, I think that's pretty much it. I covered everything. And yeah. Oh wait, hold up. There was a post-credit scene. Not sure if I should talk about it, but I guess I should. It's mainly about Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. And I kind of watched the scene on YouTube, but and you can too. I'll probably leave a link in the description. So, Wanda and Strange were kind of discussing some stuff that would later be, you know, talked about in Multiverse of Madness, but the post-credit scene was kind of setting up, you know, Multiverse of Madness, and the mid-credit scene was setting up a Battle versus Spider-Man movie. But the post-credit scene, people were wondering what happened to Strange in that scene, is what I'm trying to say, so hopefully we'll find out in Multiverse of Madness. There'll probably be more crazy dimension stuff happening in that movie as well. And so, yes, goodbye, folks.
Spider-Man No Way Home. What can I say about it? Oh my gosh. Three. Awesome. Totally awesome. Like the Trinity. I cannot believe it. On the same screen. So totally epic. I mean, hot. And I mean, hot. Spider-Man freaking hot. Whew, ladies, you're gonna love it. But anyways, best villains, best fight scenes, absolutely best superhero epic movie ever made. To this day, I would go see it again and again and again, over and over again. You hear me? Again and again and again. Pun intended. Amazing. Pun also intended. Spider-Man No Way Home. What can I say about it? Oh my gosh. Three. Awesome. Totally awesome. Like the Trinity. I cannot believe it. On the same screen. So totally epic.
I just want to say these people couldn't be here right now, so I'm doing this for them and playing the audio back on how they feel about the Spider-Man movie.
I mean, hot. And I mean, hot. Okay. Spider-Man, okay. Freaking
okay.
Hot.
Okay, enough of that. Woo! Here's person number two.
What can I say about this movie? Honestly, this movie was an 11 out of 10 film. It's one of the best I've ever seen, if not the best. I love to see all three of the Spider-Mans together. It was epic. Everyone in the theater was screaming. As soon as Toby came on the screen, it was like a breath of fresh air to see the three Spider-Mans coming together and fighting crime together and saving the world. Because with great power comes great responsibility, and they've shown immense strength. Honestly, to see them all together was just, like I said, a breath of fresh air. And Tom Holland, amazing actor. Tobey Maguire, amazing actor. Andrew Garfield, amazing actor. Andrew Garfield, honestly, is hilarious. And all three of them together had me cracking up so freaking bad. And you could just tell that those Spider-Man roles really never left them, because they are Peter Parker and nothing will ever change that. And it's like they never left their roles, because those roles will always be a part of them. I'm terribly sad about certain scenes that I won't mention, just in case anyone hasn't seen the movie that's listening to this review. But go see it, please.
I just want to stop right here and say, if you haven't seen it, if you watched this far, what are you doing? Just go watch it. Go watch it now. Don't keep watching this video. Go watch it now. Finish this video later. But that's only if you haven't seen it. This is person number three. Okay. You ready? Okay. They're kind of quiet, so give me a moment. is the third person.
Okay, the reason I like the Spider-Man movie is because I really like that all the Spider-Man characters got together into, like, one group and just fought. Like, fought for their lives. And I really like the ending, too. It was really happy, but one of the sad parts and, like, the downfall that I really didn't like was that Aunt May had to die, which was really, really sad. I was hoping that they could somehow, like, make her come back to life, but, like, I guess it's not possible. But I really like that the characters came together. Don't like the part where one of the Spider-Mans almost died. It's kind of spoiler, sorry. And I really like that I got to see the two other Spider-Mans, because I didn't get to watch neither one of their movies, because I was born after both of their movies. But one of the exciting things is that they're in the stuff, like, happy, you know. I can't wait for part four of Spider-Man, so I can't wait to see Venom in that, everything. I think it's going to be really good. One of the references I didn't like was that I didn't like there was a lot of bad enemies for Spider-Man. Like, at the beginning, I think there were, like, Octavius, and I really didn't like that.
So, let me see. My turn. Spider-Man No Way Home was one of those movies that I only heard it was good. I didn't know what to expect walking in, but it lived up to the hype, marketing, rumors, etc. Even memes. I mean, I don't want to say it lived up to my expectations, because I was expecting Firestar, Iceman, but, you know, their meetings, and, like, Kevin Feige, he just now made that X-Men movie, whatever, canon, and we're not going to talk about that today, or whatever, but my point is, they are his amazing friends, and Spidey has friends everywhere, so maybe eventually we'll see them. There was recently this storyline that Marvel had featuring Gwen X Green Goblin. So I don't know how that affects Andrew Spider-Man in this huge Spider-Verse. Maybe he'll find his Gwen in another movie with Black Cat, as that was kind of mentioned. So now I want to, like, analyze these characters and their development. Daredevil met Spidey for the first time. That's cool, even if it wasn't Marvel, because fans wanted him back. Stuff like this must happen more often. We must get Jessica Jones back. We must get that Ghost Rider back. We must get freaking Luke Cage back. All of them. Netflix. Man, there's just so many good Netflix characters that I wish could pop up in the MCU. And Tom Holland, Petey the Third, I'm gonna call him, learned to be more responsible with each new mission he got. Andrew Petey the Second, you could see he was still grieving and was able to stay strong through little stuff like jokes and how much citizens still wanted him as Spidey, so he could not move on from events like Gwen's death, his Uncle Ben's death. So he was still puzzled about who to talk to. Toby, Petey the Third, had way more experience as Spidey, so he used to he was used to much of his power when fighting his foes, which led to him being a good mentor. That was his development. Like, it was kind of like a rehabilitation process. He didn't want Tom to kill Osborn because he was afraid he'd make the same mistake as him. So hearing them all talk about Uncle Ben, even though Tom was a little unaware of the quotes because he was probably younger when his Ben died, they all helped solve the problems. Like, even Tom helped, you know, the villains, and, you know, what's his name, Toby, was all like, Andrew, you know, you'll find another girl, just wait a while, you know, one day she will come walking up to you, like something like that. But now, the film's theme, I feel like the movie was kind of intense, kind of one of those resilience movies, the way people mistreat the real heroes, especially since J. Jonah Jameson was acting all anti-mask, the way he kept saying, that Spidey menace. The way Tom Holland and Petey III stopped Doctor Strange from using the box proves that the future isn't written and we decide our own fate. Strange kept talking about the multiverse, meaning that people want the multiverse's future to remain unpredictable. Yet, if the MCU doesn't keep its promises, many of its viewers, you know, will mock the failure of the MCU's, you know, the predictions that they'll be making about, you know, the characters and, you know, their future and where their future lies.